The next item of business is a debate on motion 14398 in the name of Angela Constance on Police, Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill at Stage 1. Be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion up to 14 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to open the debate on the general principles of the Police Ethics Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. I do want to start by giving my thanks to the Criminal Justice Committee for their scrutiny of the bill. Their Stage 1 report raised several important points which I have carefully considered. I also want to thank the organisations and, of course, the individuals who have provided evidence to the committee and who have engaged intensively with the bill. The bill has been shaped by those who have had lived experience of the police complaint system, many of whom felt that the whole system was against them, that they became the victim and that there was no independent body to turn to. I also want to thank everyone in Police Scotland, the officers and staff who work tirelessly to protect and support our communities, and the vast, vast majority who conduct themselves with integrity and professionalism. Ensuring public trust in the police service is vital, and we know that we need strong processes in place to deal with complaints and allegations of wrongdoing about the police to secure that trust. And that is at the heart of this police bill. It aims to strengthen public confidence in Police Scotland, a service that operates under the principle of policing by consent. The bill gives prominence to ethical policing and supports further processes for the handling of any conduct which falls short of the high standards of professional behaviour the public rightly expect. The bill provides greater consequences for gross misconduct and enhances independent scrutiny of policing. Presiding Officer, in 2018, the Scottish Government and the Lord Advocate jointly commissioned Dame Elise Angelini to undertake an independent review of complaints handling, investigations and misconduct issues in relation to policing. Dame Elise's review was the catalyst for systemic cultural change and organisational development to deliver significant improvements in the police complaints and police misconduct processes. These improvements are helping to make both systems easier to navigate for members of the public, as well as increasing consistency, efficiency and timeliness. The bill builds on the transformative change that has already been delivered by policing partners. It makes direct changes in primary legislation and paves the way for a range of further measures which will follow in secondary legislation. The provisions in this bill cover three main themes: ethics of the police, police conduct and independent scrutiny of the police by the Police Investigation and Review Commissioner. Presiding Officer, Police Scotland officers must act in a way that secures and maintains the respect and trust of the public. They have a strong focus on respecting human rights, and Police Scotland already have a code of ethics. This bill will make it a statutory obligation to keep a code in place, reflecting its significance in setting out what the public can expect from the service, its constables and of police staff. Having a range of key stakeholders as statutory consultees helps ensure that the code is of high quality. Reflecting views heard at committee, I propose to add the Scottish Human Rights Commission and Equality and Human Rights Commissions to the list of mandatory consultees that the Chief Constable must consult when drafting the code. I also plan, reflecting on the evidence heard by the Criminal Justice Committee, to add further sources that the Chief Constable must refer to when preparing the code. As Dame Elise set out in her review, those who hold the office of constables and the powers of that office have a higher duty than others to account for their actions and record what they did or saw in the execution of their duties. The bill proposes to introduce an explicit duty of candour on individual constables and also on Police Scotland as an organisation. A duty to be candid is already implied within standards of professional behaviour. However, introducing a statutory duty of candour will make clear to all what we can expect of the police service. I very much recognise the committee's views on the application of the individual duty of candour to police staff who have statutory powers and duties in operational roles, and I intend to work with Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority on how best this could be progressed. I am happy to confirm today that I propose to amend the bill with the duty of candour provision to make it clear that candour is also required in investigations against police staff and SPA staff, not just against fellow constables. I will indeed.
Jim Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary to give way on this point and just go slightly back to the duty of candour, for which my understanding is there's the individual duty that currently applies to the Office of Constable and the organisational duty that will apply to the Chief Constable. Are there any consequences envisaged for breaches of that duty of candour, both at the level of the Constable but also, perhaps more importantly, at the level of the Chief Constable?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there are very clear responsibilities laid on the Chief Constable via the 2020 legislation, and obviously the primary focus of that in terms of holding the Chief Constable to account is via the Scottish Police Authority. In terms of consequences of whether it's the Code of Ethics or the duty of candour, it's important to recognise that professional standards and professional behaviours expected of police constables is of course set out in regulation, and while some matters it's important that they're not conflated, but there can indeed be an overlap. Presiding Officer, in addition to the committee's Stage 1 report, their committee made a number of key recommendations to strengthen the framework around vetting. My officials have engaged extensively with the policing partners with a focus on how the recommendation can be delivered in practice, and I am happy to confirm that I am considering in detail how best to implement the recommendations from HMICS ahead of Stage 2. Presiding Officer, the bill also proposes changes relating to the handling of police misconduct cases. Dame Elish's review recommended the transfer of certain functions from the SPA to the PIRC to enhance independent scrutiny and remove any perception of familiarity between those subject to allegations and the person considering the matter. The bill amends the Police and Fire Reform Scotland Act 2012 to enable the expansion of the role of the PIRC in senior officer misconduct cases through measures to be taken forward in secondary legislation. Currently, where there is an allegation of misconduct and the subject officer resigns or retires, any live proceedings come to a halt. Committee heard that this creates a perception that officers who are guilty of serious wrongdoing can escape scrutiny and consequences. Committee also heard from officers who are frustrated that they could not clear their name. There is therefore a strong public interest in dealing with allegations of gross misconduct after officers leave the service, and the bill delivers on this by ensuring disciplinary procedures can apply to former constables in the most serious cases. I agree with the committee that investigations into former officers should be completed as timeously as possible. And I am very much aware that any delay prolongs the impact on victims and on officers. And I commit to exploring ways to mitigate against this with policing partners. The bill provides for the police advisory list and the police barred list. This list will help in capturing and sharing information about former police constables who have or who are suspected of having engaged in serious misconduct, and this will support police vetting across the UK. There is also provision that removes the requirement for the SPA to determine senior officer misconduct cases, paving the way for an independent panel to determine cases, and this will address any concerns around perceived proximity between the authority and senior officers and strengthen the independence of proceedings. Presiding Officer, the primary purpose of the PIRC is to increase public confidence in policing through independent scrutiny of Police Scotland's actions. As Dame Elish said, the organisation's higher purpose is having a body that people can go to when they are dissatisfied or do not have the trust and confidence in the police. The bill adds a suite of new powers for the PIRC that will strengthen independent investigation and oversight of the police complaints system. It extends the ability for the PIRC to investigate offences where it is suspected that it was committed by a person who was or is serving with the police, regardless of whether they were on or off duty. This will avoid the police investigating someone when there could be concerns that the investigator has a connection with them. The bill puts beyond doubt that the PIRC's power to review complaints made by persons serving with the police, police officers and staff who experience poor service, it will have the ability to request a complaint handling review by the PIRC or to request the PIRC calls in their complaint. This gives police officers and staff an external body to go to if they are dissatisfied with the way their complaint was handled. While the PIRC currently has the ability to make recommendations to Police Scotland regarding the handling of individual complaints, the bill will put this into statute alongside requirements that the SPA or the Chief Constable respond to the recommendations made. It provides the PIRC with a power to decide to take over consideration of complaints, and this will strengthen the role of the PIRC, enabling faster resolution and greater scrutiny of Police Scotland and the SPA complaint handling. In turn, it will provide reassurance that there is an independent oversight body if the complaint in question it has not been properly considered. I very much welcome the committee's recommendation that the bill should be amended to provide for an expectation that PIRC will publish Police Scotland and SPA responses to PIRC recommendations unless there are operational reasons not to do so, and I can confirm I will bring forward a Stage 2 amendment to address that. The bill gives PIRC the duty to audit the handling of whistleblowing complaints to improve how these public interest matters are investigated. This will encourage people to speak up when they see wrongdoing and provides an opportunity for Police Scotland and the SPA to learn and to address the issues raised. The bill also gives the PIRC new functions investigating serious incidents or criminal offences involving constables from forces outside Scotland, which occur in Scotland. And this will help provide a basis for discussions to put in place reciprocal powers for other UK jurisdictions. Presiding Officer, in order to support Police Scotland to improve, the bill will provide PIRC with a specific new power to review a policy or practice of the SPA or Police Scotland. This new power could be used when PIRC becomes aware of a trend, theme or practice emerging in the discharge of its other statutory functions. The bill also enables regulations to be made to allow the PIRC direct access to Police Scotland's complaints database independently and remotely, with the intention of improving transparency and public confidence in the system. The final section of the bill introduces a statutory advisory board for the PIRC on governance and administrative matters. The governance design will ensure the Commissioner's operational independence and decision-making autonomy. Presiding Officer, let me finish by again thanking the committee for its support for the general principles of this bill, which will make improvements to policing, and I very much look forward to the debate this afternoon and the contribution made by members. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Audrey Nicholl to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. Up to 13 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to open this afternoon's debate on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. And as ever, the committee is very grateful to our clerking team, Spice, and other parliamentary staff for their assistance and support during our scrutiny of the bill. And as ever, I'm grateful to members of the committee for the conciliatory way in which we worked together. So the committee gave detailed consideration to the proposals in the bill. This afternoon, I will focus on gross misconduct proceedings, the introduction of a barred and advisory list, the time taken to deal with complaints, new powers proposed for the PERC, and whistleblowing. And I would like to place on record our sincere thanks to those who told us about their experiences of the police complaints and conduct systems and provided their views on how these should be improved. We heard from people who had made complaints as well as a former officer who had been the subject of a complaint. And their evidence highlighted the need for an effective, fair and transparent police complaint system that works for members of the public and police officers and staff. And the conclusions and recommendations in our Stage 1 report were agreed without division. However, for some members of the committee, their support of the general principles of the bill is dependent on the provision of an updated financial memorandum at Stage 1. During Stage 1, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs provided the committee with the most up-to-date cost estimates and gave a commitment to provide a revised financial memorandum if the bill is amended at Stage 2. So I would like to highlight some of the main findings of our Stage 1 report. The bill contains a number of provisions which aim to improve confidence in the police complaints and conduct systems. The committee recognises that the vast majority of police officers and staff are dedicated, honest and hardworking and do an incredibly difficult job on our behalf. And we welcome the introduction of a statutory code of ethics and consideration being given to the committee reviewing the draft code. And we also welcome the introduction of a duty of candour and the Scottish Police Authority's consideration of whether such a duty should apply to staff. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's update regarding a duty of candour for staff this afternoon. The committee recognises that when the standard of behaviour of officers falls below what the public might expect, there needs to be accountability. A key issue which the bill addresses is to enable gross misconduct proceedings to continue or commence when a person ceases to be a constable. The procedures will apply where a preliminary assessment of the misconduct allegation finds that the conduct of the person, while they were a constable, would, if proved, amount to gross misconduct. And we heard about the impact on those who make complaints, as well as those who are the subject of a complaint, when gross misconduct proceedings are not brought to a conclusion. In their evidence to us, June and Hugh MacLeod described the devastating impact on their family when an officer retired just days prior to facing a disciplinary hearing for gross misconduct. And Mr. and Mrs. MacLeod said that this clearly denied us justice and had left us seeking answers over the police investigation into our son's death. And former police officer Ian Clark told the committee that if the misconduct proceedings had continued to a conclusion after he had retired, he would have a record that there had been no misconduct on his part. Mr. Clark said that to be accused of something and to have no formal resolution is wrong. It allows the guilty to walk away with no consequences and the innocent to have suspicion hanging over them for the rest of their lives. The committee welcomes these provisions. Although not a specific provision in the bill, we considered what would be a proportionate length of time to commence gross misconduct proceedings where a person had ceased to be an officer. We concluded that cases should be able to commence up to 12 months after an officer has left employment, and that any cases raised after 12 months should be subject to a public interest test. The committee recommended that this should be a clear commitment and contained in regulation. We also recommended that the Scottish Police Authority monitors this process over the initial years to ensure that gross misconduct cases are dealt with timeously. The Scottish Government confirmed that its intention is that gross misconduct proceedings can continue to conclusion, however long this takes. And these measures should provide confidence to the public that officers will be held to account for gross misconduct, as well as providing a conclusion for those officers who wish to clear their name. Turning to vetting, Section 7 of the Bill enables the Scottish Police Authority to establish and maintain a Scottish Police Advisory List and a Scottish Police Barred List. A person would be entered on the advisory list where disciplinary proceedings had been brought against them for gross misconduct, either after they ceased to be a constable or where they ceased to be a constable before those proceedings were concluded. A person would be entered on the barred list if they were dismissed for gross misconduct or would have been dismissed had they not already ceased to be a police officer at that point. And the committee welcomes the introduction of these lists. They are an important vetting tool which will provide a consistent approach across police forces in Great Britain. And we recommended that Scotland follows the practice in England and Wales, where the barred list is published, but only relevant organisations are able to access the advisory list. So, turning to time taken to deal with complaints, another key issue is the time taken by policing bodies and Crown Office to deal with complaints. In its report, the committee concluded that the evidence we received clearly indicates that the bill, as introduced, will have little impact on the length of time taken to consider and conclude police complaints. And I welcome the clarification from the Scottish Government that the current regulations do not prohibit misconduct proceedings from happening when there are possible criminal proceedings, and confirmation that there may be a workable solution to address this issue that does not require legislation. The Scottish Government also confirmed that it is consulting with the Scottish Police Consultative Forum on the introduction of accelerated gross misconduct hearings for all ranks of officers under certain circumstances. These measures are very welcome. However, the committee would like to see further measures introduced to deal with the time taken to deal with complaints. In particular, robust oversight and monitoring of the effectiveness of Police Scotland's centralised professional standards department. The committee welcomes the provisions in the bill which strengthen the role of the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner. Section 11 of the bill enables the Commissioner to carry out a complaint handling review without a request from the complainer, Police Scotland or the Scottish Police Authority, if the Commissioner considers that it is in the public interest to do so. It also includes a requirement for the SPA and Police Scotland to respond to the Commissioner's recommendations within the timescales set out in the PERCS report. And in response to the committee's recommendations that the SPA and Police Scotland should be under a duty to comply with PERCS recommendations, the Commissioner welcomed some element of accountability for organisations in receipt of our recommendations in respect of implementation or compliance. However, the Commissioner also highlighted the benefits of retaining flexibility to remedy an issue in a different manner. Section 12 provides the Commissioner with a power to take over consideration of or call in complaints being dealt with by the Chief Constable or the SPA under certain circumstances. This could be if the Commissioner has reasonable grounds to believe that the appropriate authority is not handling or has not handled the complaint properly. And it is in the public interest for the Commissioner to consider the complaint. Section 15 provides the Commissioner with a bespoke power to review the practices and policies of the police generally, and not just in relation to a particular incident. And this would enable the Commissioner to address a recurring issue being raised by members of the public. Section 16 of the Bill enables Scottish ministers to make regulations allowing PIRC to access Police Scotland's conduct and complaints electronic storage system or an SPA electronic storage system if required. And these new powers for the Commissioner have the potential to improve the transparency and robustness of the police complaints process and to improve public trust and confidence in the handling of police complaints. Finally, on whistleblowing, the Bill provides the Commissioner with powers to audit and report on the arrangements in place for the investigation and of information provided in a whistleblowing complaint. The Committee recommended that the Commissioner and the SPA should be independent third parties to investigate whistleblowing complaints by those working in policing in Scotland. And it's important that there are relevant independent third parties for employees of Police Scotland and the SPA to report whistleblowing concerns to. And we understand that this will require changes to UK legislation, and it would be very helpful if the Cabinet Secretary could confirm whether she supports this recommendation. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Bill contains a number of measures to ensure that there are robust, clear and transparent mechanisms in place for investigating complaints, allegations of misconduct or other issues of concern in relation to the conduct of police officers in Scotland. And if Parliament agrees to the general principles today, we stand as ever ready to scrutinise the Bill at Stage 2. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. I now call on Russell Finlay to open on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks also to the committee clerks who do such incredible work on our behalf. Scotland's police officers are true heroes. They serve the public with care, professionalism and integrity. Shift patterns are tough, the work on work-life balance and the hours are long. Their job is often dangerous and thankless. And I was pleased last year to attend the Scottish Police Federation Awards, which showcased officers' life-saving bravery and commitment to their communities. And yesterday, we were also able to remember and recognise this ethos of selfless duty on Emergency Services Day, which is supported by His Majesty the King. Shockingly, and I make no apologies for raising this again today, officers here in Scotland are still not protected by body-worn cameras. For years, this has been standard kit across the UK, and they're proven to prevent vexatious complaints against officers. Now, for today's Stage 1 speech, I will begin by explaining why Scotland's police officers and the public expect and deserve a fair, efficient and effective system of complaints. I'll end by asking whether this bill will do the job that it is supposed to do. Will it provide remedy for those who have been wronged? And with immense pressure on policing budgets, is it affordable? Now, Police Scotland was created 11 years ago in 2013. The surrounding landscape of regulation and complaints is complex and confusing. Frankly, it just doesn't work. The Scottish Police Authority is supposed to hold Police Scotland to account on behalf of the public. Too often, it does not do so. And the Police Investigation and Review Commissioner should investigate the misconduct of officers above senior rank, so not the rank and file, which means that allegations made against the vast majority of police officers are handled by the police. It is kept in-house. As an MSP, and before that as a journalist, I've represented those who have been wronged by way of negligence, misconduct or even criminality. Some of these people gave up their time to give evidence to the committee, and I thank them. They are often deprived of natural justice. The complexity of the process is daunting and secretive. Too often, cases drag on for far too long. There have been shocking cases in which Police Scotland watered down serious allegations, with criminal acts, including an alleged rape, being recorded as, quote, incivility. On other occasions, Police Scotland failed in its duty to report criminal allegations made against officers to the Crown Office. If complainers do get as far as PIRC, they often discover that the police watchdog is pretty toothless. Stephanie Bonner was one of those who gave up her time to give evidence to the committee, and I thank her again personally for doing so. By following the unexplained death of her teenage son, Rhys, Stephanie's pain was compounded by her dealings with the police. She describes the process as a, quote, hellish merry-go-round. I don't know, but perhaps some in the policing establishment believe that a process that helps to get rid of what it sees as troublesome complaints is a good thing. But I disagree. The reality is an unfair system only fuels injustice and risks harming all officers by eroding public trust and confidence. If lost, this will be hard to repair. And this broken system fails officers just as badly as it fails members of the public. As a politician and as a journalist, I've represented of police whistleblowers who tried to report wrongdoing only to then become targets. The full power of Police Scotland was weaponised against them and used to tie them up in knots, ostracise them, silence them and crush them. Many of these officers are female. They made a brave stand against sexist bullying long before two successive chief constables held their hands up and admitted to institutionalised discrimination. In a few cases, they emerged with some compensation and an apology. In others, the misery continues. It's an absolute scandal that so many good officers have had their careers, health and finances so needlessly destroyed. I know of one officer who took his own life after becoming trapped in the complaints process. His family and colleagues believe that this was a contributory factor in his suicide. So it was against this backdrop the government finally took action in 2018 by asking the former Lord Advocate, Lady Elish Angelini, to investigate. Her final report, which was published in November 2020, is truly damning. For me, one of her many critical words stood out is, and I quote, inaccessible. It's not a harsh word, but I think it helpfully encapsulates the near impossibility of the task for those seeking justice and redress. And I refer back to my earlier observation about a system that deters and deflects valid complaints. The short-term gain of a difficult issue disappearing potentially yields greater long-term harm of increased public mistrust. Now, Lady Elish made 111 recommendations, some of which required legislation, which is why this bill is in front of us. It's welcome that many of her non-legislative recommendations have been enacted, just as encouraging is the ready acceptance of them by Scotland's policing establishment. I've also detected in recent years a willing to change the policing culture from within, because a changed culture may achieve more or as much as a code of ethics and the duty of candour in this legislation. Now, I've only got 10 minutes today. There are parts of this bill that we like, such as measures to increase transparency, with some serious misconduct hearings being held in public, and investigations continuing in the event of officers leaving their post. But it would take longer than that to properly set out some of our concerns about this bill. The committee has detailed its concerns in our lengthy Stage 1 report, to which members can refer. I'm certain that many of today's speakers will raise these most pressing issues in greater detail. But one of them does relate to the cost of the legislation. The initial financial memorandum stated the cost to be just over £1.4 million. That price tag has rocketed to £5.8 million. And as all of us know, that number is only likely to go in one direction. It was alarming to hear the Scottish Police Federation tell the committee that they thought the total cost could rise by as much as tenfold. It's also deeply concerning that the Parliament's Finance Committee said the government had provided figures that it knew, quote, were completely inaccurate. Now, going forward, our party will expect full clarity around cost. We did not formally include that as a condition of supporting the bill at Stage 1, but it can be taken as read. We will not be writing a blank cheque. But since our Stage 1 report was published, we've received responses from various policing bodies. These responses are, of course, welcome, but not without their own concern. PIRC, for example, has provided a 20-page response containing various points, including concerns about its role and responsibilities if this bill goes through unchanged. Now, one of the main Angelini recommendations was to give PIRC greater powers and to make it answerable to this Parliament instead of ministers. The government doesn't seem keen on this proposal, and it's something that my party intends to explore further. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's proposed amendments today and will examine these fully in due course. And myself and my colleagues intend to make various amendments of our own. These are a work in progress and will be for another day. And while we support the bill at Stage 1, this is very much unfinished business. Scotland's brave and dedicated police officers and those who rely on them know that we have to get this right. A modern, transparent, speedy and fair system is the prize. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call on Polly McNeill to open on behalf of Scottish Labour. Around 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. Scottish Labour welcomes the opportunity to discuss the main provisions in this bill, how we can ensure the highest standards in conduct and police service. But we are clear that the government must resolve the financial memorandum. It is important that victims and families are given more robust accountability, but it's unclear whether the bill will change much for ordinary people and for members of the public who have been dissatisfied when they complained about police service. Cabinet Secretary talks about faster resolution and more independent scrutiny. We must be able to demonstrate it in this bill if we're to vote for it at Stage 3. So the bill creates a new duty of candour. Clearly, the vast majority of police officers already adhere to the principles contained within a duty of candour. The government says in its response to the Stage 1 report that the duty is to bring out measurable change. Most tangibly, the duty is to become a standard professional behaviour for police constables. And this means that if a constable fails without any good reason to evidence candour, they could be subject to disciplinary proceedings. Now, I think it's not a word that we've used before or heard before in legislation, so I think we must be absolutely clear what it means and what the implications are. The Stage 1 report specifically noted that the duty of candour applies to circumstances that happen off duty. In the response, Police Scotland have asked for care to be taken when asking officers to adhere to a duty of candour when they are off duty because of the possible impact on their private lives. I have sympathy with that position. Police Scotland say extending a duty of candour into off-duty circumstances could have potential Article 8 ECHR implications in relation to officer rights and impacts on their private lives, where they may be expected to provide candour in relation to a matter which they have significant and disproportionate implications not only on them but on their families and themselves. So I think that's something that needs further discussion since it's been raised by Police Scotland itself. So I would like more clarity in what it means in practice. Does the government expect more conduct hearings, for example, as a result of adopting this phrase in the legislation when the new duty comes into force? So I want to talk about the proposal for accelerated disciplinary hearings proposed by Police Scotland. Conduct hearings are currently often incredibly lengthy. And Deputy Chief Constable Alan Spears told the committee that Police Scotland has an officer who is probably 3 years into their suspension. David Kennedy from the Scottish Police Federation notes that the timeline is supposed to be 35 days from start to finish, but the vast majority are probably 365 days or more. So you can see that there's an incredible amount of work needing to be done here. The Stage 1 report notes that DCC Spears has described the conduct regulations as not fit for purpose, and says that there's an inability to fast-track a process. It seems reasonable that there should be an amendment to expedite conduct hearings, as have been asked for. Certainly, where an officer does not accept the charge of misconduct, then those proceedings should follow to allow that officer to rebut the charges. But I think in instances where that's already accepted, there doesn't seem to be any reason why that shouldn't happen. Now, I want to go on to talk about gross misconduct proceedings. And I just want to be clear, I think we should be clear, that when we talk about gross misconduct, it's quite a separate matter from misconduct. I was listening carefully, Cabinet Secretary, to this point, and you interchangeably used the word misconduct with gross misconduct. And, but I think that's important because gross misconduct usually implies a more serious matter than conduct. And that's why I think the committee would all agree that some of the terminology in the bill has been hard to follow, because sometimes you're talking about senior ranks, sometimes you're talking about all ranks, and sometimes you're talking about misconduct and gross misconduct. But the expected 12-month timescale that's been referred to, where you could commence gross misconduct proceedings, as the Cabinet Secretary said to the committee, that is not on the face of the bill. But as the Stage 1 report stands, has confirmed that it's not a hard and fast statutory requirement, but it would be for the Commissioner to make a judgment on public interest and fairness based on all the facts and circumstances. So I do think that some of these caveats probably should be on the face of the bill, because I think we need to require certainty when we're creating something new here. The Government's response states that these proceedings are commenced within the time period they can continue to conclusion, however long that takes. I don't think that's satisfactory. Whether you agree 12 months is the right time period or not, I think there should be a time period for completion of those proceedings. Presiding Officer, I mean, there is quite a bit of structural change within that the committee did wrestle with in relation to changes that would result in more independent scrutiny. So the structure of how police officers are investigated, for example, PIRC has been given a greater role in relation to misconduct proceedings for senior officers. And in fact, PIRC doesn't agree with all the recommendations, and that's a cause for concern too, because if a body is being asked to take on more responsibility, then you would at least expect them to be happy and content to do that. Scottish Labour said in the Stage 1 report that we wouldn't vote for the general principles of the bill unless the question of the finances were resolved. In conclusion, what I'll say is that we will take on good faith that the Government have, since the report was published, outlined or clarified that it's not possible to amend a financial memorandum at Stage 1, but they would take on the issue at Stage 2. So we will listen carefully. As Russell Finlay has also said, it's not really satisfactory to make substantial changes to a bill that's going to cost money in order to make those changes if the Government are not prepared to put the money where it's required. And if we don't get those guarantees, they will not vote for the bill in Stage 3. But let's hope we can make progress in Stage 2. And just finally, in the summing up, Cabinet Secretary, you said that there were recommendations from HMICS that you would also look at Stage 2. And please forgive me if I should know what these are, but as I said, I am personally struggling with all the acronyms and recommendations. It would be really helpful if you could, in summing up, say exactly what those recommendations are, so we get some advance warning of what we might be facing at Stage 2. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And I now call on Maggie Chapman to open on behalf of Scottish Greens. Around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, I welcome this bill and the reforms which it contains. These reforms, of course, as we've already heard, represent a further step in the implementation of the Angelini Review into complaints handling, investigations and misconduct in relation to policing. I thank members of the Criminal Justice Committee for their meticulous scrutiny of the bill at Stage 1, and I look forward to further discussion of the points which they have raised. I thank too the committee clerks and researchers for all the work they have done and the support to the committee, and indeed thank all those who contributed at Stage 1, individuals, organisations who gave evidence as witnesses, submitted briefings or other information during this process. We live in a society where the institution of the police holds considerable power, both in terms of the acts or omissions of individual officers and in its corporate response to scrutiny. That power has often been misused, sometimes with tragic consequences. We've heard some examples this afternoon. It is our duty as lawmakers to recognise, to respond to, and to help redress those wrongs. People who have experienced harm from police action or inaction deserve to receive respectful, timely, and appropriate treatment through processes that are clear and fair, with outcomes that include full and candid truth-telling, reparation where it is needed, and assurance that lessons have been learned. There is much in this bill which can, if properly implemented, help both to reduce the level of misconduct by police officers and to improve the process by which misconduct and injustice are investigated and addressed. It is important that every police officer understands, accepts, and lives out the ethics which we expect of them. Those ethics have rightly deepened and developed over the past decades, but they cannot always be taken for granted. It's important that every police officer bears and follows the duty to be open and truthful when something has gone wrong. The existence of that duty will be a benefit to the great majority of police officers who will want to be able to fully explain what has happened without the sense that in doing so they are somehow letting down their colleagues or their corporate body. And it is crucial that in implementing these provisions, the rights of workers, of police officers and civilian staff are properly protected. We must have clear and independent processes for calling the police to account, including senior officers and those who leave the force before their actions are investigated. And we must have means of ensuring that if a police officer has behaved badly in one part of the UK, they are not able to do the same elsewhere. Robust vetting procedures can help ensure both that the right people are recruited and that they continue to be the right people to be trusted with the exercise of police power. And the work of the Police Investigations Review Commissioner must be both effective and efficient, getting both its functions and its governance right. But legislation alone cannot bring about all the changes we need to see. There are fundamental problems with the institution of a police force, any police force, which won't be easily fixed. It isn't an accident, a weird anomaly, that Police Scotland has been acknowledged by its own senior officers as being institutionally racist and discriminatory. It isn't an accident that the victims and survivors of police misconduct, injustice and brutality are overwhelmingly those who are already marginalised, whose identities are already viewed as problematic, whose voices are already silenced. For the historic roots of the police in Britain and beyond lie in colonialism, the suppression of democratic movements, and the capitalist imperative to defeat organised labour. Those foundational purposes, they might not be overtly present today, but they determine why we have something called a police force at all, and cannot help but underlie what governments, media, political discourse, and police officers themselves expect that force to do. We can be rightly proud of Police Scotland in many ways, comparing it to other police forces across the UK and the world. Much good work has been done, and much more is continuing. We have all, I imagine, had positive encounters in our work and in our personal lives with police officers who are kind, thoughtful, sensitive, and empathetic. But we must, I think, recognise that Scottish exceptionalism in this, as in other areas, isn't always justified. Policing by consent too often means only the consent of people like us in places like this. So yes, the Scottish Greens will vote for the principles of this bill today. We will work with others across this chamber and across civil society to make it as fair, as effective, and as worthwhile as it can possibly be over the course of the coming weeks and months. But we have, as I've indicated, some broader questions to ask. Not just here, but here is a good place to start. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I look forward to hearing more of the debate this afternoon and to returning to these issues in the days and weeks ahead as we grapple with amendments to this bill, as we must. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And we will now move to the open debate. Backbench speeches of around 6 minutes. I would advise members that we do have some time in hand, so if members wish to seek to make or to take interventions, that would be very helpful. And I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Jamie Green. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Justice Committee, I welcome the chance to speak in today's important debate. The bill has been brought forward using the recommendations from the 2020 review into the complaints handling, investigations and misconduct issues in policing by Lady Eilish Angelini. Presiding Officer, firstly, I'd like to recognise the fantastic work of Police Scotland and its officers, and I'm confident that for many officers, this bill will be a bit inconsequential to how they conduct themselves on a day-to-day basis within their role in our communities. One recent example was the anti-racist demonstration in Glasgow's George Square last weekend, where police organised calmly and efficiently to avoid clashes between protesters. Local police in my constituency of Strathkelvin and Bearsden took part in a recovery walk last week organised by a fantastic aftercare recovery charity called Grace. And they were praised by everyone in the community for the good-natured and friendly way in which they took part. However, during committee evidence, we heard witnesses, police and members of the public tell of their experience, which was concerning due to the lack of transparency, communication and, crucially, the long delays in getting matters resolved. I think Russell Finlay highlighted acutely what they were. Lady Angelini's recommendations reflect this, and the bill aims to ensure that our police service is held to a high ethical standard throughout all aspects of their role, which will help public confidence in the service and encourage a higher level of transparency. So I believe this bill will achieve what it sets out to do with amendments, in particular to improve the culture and public confidence when policing, when dealing with complaints. However, its progress must be reviewed and monitored as to its effectiveness, as this was a concern raised in the committee's Stage 1 report. So the bill makes changes in four key areas. The first part is the requirement for a code of ethics, which will be drawn up by the Chief Constable with the assistance of the Scottish Police Authority, and it will be reviewed every 5 years. The Scottish Police Federation is of the view that the non-statutory code of ethics, which exists at the moment, is sufficient. However, HMICS believes it will set in statute what's expected of officers, and the Association of Police Superintendents view as an opportunity to improve Police Scotland's internal culture, but say that must include equality, diversity and inclusion training as a refresher for all officers. And can I just thank Russell Finlay for highlighting the long-standing problems of sexism and bullying within the service. And the issue of culture is one which has been repeatedly raised. And in my view, anything that can be done to embed equality and inclusion in the police service can only be a good thing. Section 3 of the bill seeks to give legal recognition to a duty of candour on individual police constables and includes the principle that Police Scotland should police in a way that's candid and cooperative, particularly in regard to the investigation of conduct of officers. And I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary has said she'll amend the bill to include operational staff in this duty of candour. Not surprisingly, witnesses and those with experience of the police complaints procedure were broadly in favour of these measures. But some did express doubt about what difference it would make if there were no sanctions for officers and staff who choose not to cooperate with the investigations. Regarding police misconduct, the bill will help strengthen public confidence, for example, by ensuring officers can no longer resign to avoid being held to account for gross misconduct allegations against them. An advisory list and a barred list of people who are or have been subject to proceedings under the procedures for misconduct will be created, and our convener outlined articulately the effect that this will have. The Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, or PIRC as it's known, is given significant new powers and in turn will strengthen its governance and accountability arrangements. The PIRC will have the ability to investigate when it's suspected that the offence was committed by a person who formerly served with the police. The committee recommends, and I am of the strong view, that PIRC should continue its policy to reduce the reliance and on the employment of former police officers and introduce procedures to ensure that people who have worked together previously must declare an interest and are actually prevented from investigating one another. The bill provides the PIRC with the power to take over the consideration of complaints that are being dealt with by the Chief Constable or the Scottish Police Authority. But due to improve transparency, the PIRC will have a duty to audit the arrangements for investigating whistleblowing complaints. And I think that will encourage people to speak up when they see wrongdoing. And it will also be given new functions to investigate serious incidents or criminal offending that occurs in Scotland that involve constables from forces outside Scotland. To improve efficiency and transparency, independence and public confidence in the complaints process, the bill does pave the way for the PIRC to independently and remotely have direct access to audit and review files in Police Scotland's complaints database. and to strengthen decision-making, the Bill puts into place a statutory advisory board to advise the PIRC on governance and administrative matters. The committee would have concerns if any investigations into gross misconduct took longer than is necessary, and that this is a really important point of this bill. The government is looking into ways that this could be done if any investigation into an officer who has left the force have to be completed as timeously as possible. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, the bill will improve how complaints about the police are dealt with, help increase transparency and strengthen public confidence. It does aim to simplify the way complaints, allegations of misconduct and other concerns about the conduct of police officers are investigated. And crucially, it will help to assure the public that if police officer conduct or behaviour falls short of expectations, this will be properly dealt with. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Mr Green.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you. Ethics, conduct and scrutiny, those are in the opening title of this bill, and there are very few places in public life where those three words are more important. Arguably politics is one of them, but policing certainly is the other. Because when it comes to that power that we afford on our fellow citizens, the power to arrest and investigate each other, as commissioned, then ethics, conduct and scrutiny are essential, not just to protect us as members of the public, but to protect trust and confidence in those very powers that we afford. That's something that other members have mentioned. But it's been six years since the Scottish Government first announced an independent review into Police Scotland's complaint process. And it's been 4 years since the much-heralded Angeline report was published, both its preliminary and then final summary, which contained nigh on 100 recommendations, a number of which are yet to be implemented. And this bill will certainly not address all of them, but it does go some way to address some of them. I thought very carefully about what I might say and how I might say it in today's... it's in a minute. I'll just make some progress first, Cabinet Secretary, because I do want to make this wider point. It is very difficult to legislate in areas like this. Because effectively, what we're saying is we want to make changes or further improve the ethics and code of conduct of our police force. And in doing so, we acknowledge the hard work that they currently do. But we have a duty. We have a duty as legislators to protect the public, to ensure that there's constant need of revising and reviewing whether these things are working. And the Angeline report was very good at identifying many areas where it is not. But we also have a duty to protect police officers themselves. And I think one of the things that we must be very careful about is the tone and language we use in debates like this. And other colleagues have mentioned the incredibly difficult circumstances in which many of our police officers work and face. We've all been to the SPF awards at Dynamic Earth across the world. We've all met some of the hardworking officers, and we know some of the difficulties they face. But this is important, this review. And why is it important? Because, as we've heard, the current processes of complaint are met with a number of responses. And I'm going to use some of the terminology that was used in evidence to the committee. Clumsy, cumbersome, complex, off-putting, and it takes too long. Now, that's all big red flags to me that something has to be addressed. Any MSP in this place will have dealt with casework of people making or finding it very difficult to make complaints about the police to the police. We also have a duty to improve practices that root out individuals that have somehow failed the vetting process. Now, that's inevitable. The Police Scotland, amongst its commission and civilian staff, is an organisation of over 23,000 people. That's a big public sector body. So, of course, people are going to fall through the cracks. And, of course, there will be bad faith actors in any large organisation like that. But it is important that the public have confidence that we are addressing those. And that comes back to the other point of public faith in processes, because policing by consent is necessary, and therefore that necessitates robust codes of conduct and a permanent review of how effective they are. But also, and the final point that I want to make on that, is protecting officers themselves, because malicious complaints can and do happen, and therefore the processes in place to deal with those complaints need to be effective. Much of this came about over the last few years as a result of very well-publicised and horrific situations where serving members of various police forces had committed terrific crimes, of course, the most famous being that of the Met officer, Wayne Cousins. But one thing that struck me was the Met's response to that comparative to Police Scotland's response to this wider societal debate. The Met Office immediately introduced a number of changes, which I found very welcome. There was an immediate independent review of its culture and practices. There was a review into all current investigations into sexual misconduct or domestic abuse, where the accused was a police officer. There was a sample of cases over the last 10 years, a root and branch review of its recruitment, vetting processes, and more importantly, an increase of the number of investigators to deal with the timescales and the backlogs that exist here in Scotland. Now, we might say, well, that's the Met. They have issues. They've had issues for a long time. How is that relevant to us? I get the distinct impression that we, with the exceptionalism that we often think we have, is that we don't have those skills of problems because we haven't had the high-profile types of attacks that have happened south of the border. But that doesn't detract from the problem that there are still nearly 2,000 complaints remaining unsolved here in Scotland, of which 1,200 have yet to be allocated an investigator, and 684 have been allocated an investigator but are yet to conclude, and I suspect are taking a very long time. I want to address this issue of the so-called duty of cooperation, duty of candour, and the limited time that I have in Section 3 of the Bill. The government seems to imply that the duty of candour is simply a terminology difference from the duty of cooperation that was in the Angelini report and has been introduced in England and Wales. I hear there may be some amendments coming forward. I'll listen with great interest to those, but it's still unclear as to whether there's the perception, particularly amongst PERC, that the duty of candour goes far enough to meet the requirements of a duty of cooperation. And finally on PERC, this bill makes in a number of sections quite sweeping reforms to the powers that it has. But the thing that struck me the most in the response by PERC to the Stage 1 report was that actually they feel that perhaps some of these powers are unwanted by PERC themselves. Michelle McLeod, the Commissioner, stated in that response that she still believes that PERC is now carrying out the preliminary investigation, the assessment, they are making the decisions, they are presenting the case, and that there is perhaps a perception there are no checks and balances within that process. That's an important point of feedback. And ultimately, one legal representative said that the biggest criticism of this bill was quite simply that the vast majority of complaints will still be made to the police, dealt with by the police and handled by the police, and that there may be a perception that there's not enough independent or autonomous investigation into that. I won't rehearse some of the arguments about finances in the interest of time, but I have to say a financial memorandum that is £4 million out at Stage 1 really needs some serious consideration. The Finance Committee will certainly have words to say about that. I think the government ministers, but also the senior civil servants that support them in these financial memorandums really need to have a serious think about some of the charges laid against them in that respect. I close where I started. Policing is done in this country through consent of its citizens. But to have that consent, the police must maintain respect and confidence in the public. And that's been rattled in recent years, but we can fix that. This legislation will go some way, but I do question this. Could more be done here and now whilst we wait for the legislation to pass? I think the answer is yes.
Thank you, Mr Green. I now call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Claire Baker. Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And to follow on from Jamie Green, I think we can all be proud in this Parliament to live in a country that abides by the principles of policing by consent. At its most basic, this means that I and I think the rest of the Scottish public view our police services legitimate, with the implicit understanding that the police will be transparent about their powers, act with integrity while using those powers and be accountable for their actions. And I want to outline from the beginning, as others have, that I fully trust that Scotland is greatly served by the outstanding diligence and commitment of our police officers and the work they do every day to keep our communities safe across the country. The bill that we are discussing today can be seen as a way to strengthen this social contract by reinforcing public confidence in standards of police conduct. As a member of the Criminal Justice Committee, I would like to put on record my thanks to all those who gave evidence at Stage 1, particularly those with lived experience of the system, and of course the excellent clerking team who ably helped us navigate what is clearly a very complicated landscape, and I'm very much with Pauline McNeill on that. A recent Spice report acknowledged that news stories and incidents within the public domain across the UK in recent years may have contributed to an undermining of public confidence in the police and concerns around scrutiny of their behaviour. This bill seeks to improve how complaints about the police are dealt with, to help increase transparency and strengthen public confidence that may have been undermined. And this is a bill that will benefit the interests of both the public and of the police force themselves. The genesis of the bill, as we have heard, can be seen with the commissioning of the Independent Review of Complaints Handling by the Scottish Government and the Lord Advocate, which was led by former Lord Advocate Lady Angelini. Following the publication of the final report in late 2020, the Scottish Government ran a public consultation whereby feedback demonstrated broad support for the legislative changes that were recommended by the independent report. And I now want to take some time to go over each area of the bill, though, as I've said already, as a committee, we did feel it was a very complex area with a lot of interacting factors that must be taken into account, and so this is indeed a very brief overview. Firstly, sections 2 and 3 cover the ethics of the police. They include creating a statutory obligation for Police Scotland to have a code of ethics and placing a statutory duty of candour on individual officers and Police Scotland as an organisation. Not only would there be an obligation to introduce a code of ethics, but it would be the responsibility of the Chief Constable to regularly review and disseminate this code. These sections reflect the acknowledgement that those who hold the office of Constable and the powers of that office have a higher duty than others to account for their actions and record what they did or saw in the execution of their duties. Therefore, an explicit duty of candour on individual constables in Police Scotland as a whole will be introduced. Secondly, sections 4 to 8 cover aspects of police conduct. This includes amending the functions that can be conferred on the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, providing the power to allow misconduct procedures to be applied to former officers, introducing police advisory and bad lists, and amending the misconduct procedures for senior officers. The ability to allow misconduct procedures to be applied to former officers is an important way to ensure justice can be pursued even after a police officer retires or resigns. Public confidence will also be greatly improved by the creation of a barred and advisory list, which will stop those who do not meet the high standards expected of police officers from gaining employment in policing. Presiding officer, as highlighted in our report, the committee heard conflicting evidence on the merits of gross misconduct hearings being heard in public, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's response to this in providing clarity that any changes will indeed be brought forward in secondary legislation. We do think that if this goes ahead, then there must be provisions for vulnerable witnesses put in place. But given the evidence we heard in this, I personally remain open-minded as to what is the best option, and I'm not totally convinced of the merits based on the evidence that we've heard. I think that as we go forward with this part into stage two, assuming if stage one passes tonight, I think we must ask what we are trying to achieve here. With hearings being held in public, and I do want to go back and say that there were good arguments on both sides for that. The third part, presiding officer, which is covered in sections 9 to 16, refer to functions of the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner. These sections grant significant new powers to the park and in turn strengthen its governance and accountability arrangements. Although these sections cover an extensive range of new powers, some of the key processes being introduced are giving the PIRC the ability to investigate when it is suspected that the offence was committed by a person who formerly served within the police, giving the PIRC the power to take over any consideration of complaints that are being dealt with by the Chief Constable or the Scottish Police Authority, placing an obligation on the PIRC to audit the arrangements for investigating whistleblowing complaints, granting the PIRC the means to review a policy or practice of the Authority of Police Scotland, or Police Scotland if the PIRC considers that it would be in the public interest, and finally giving the PIRC direct access to audit and review files in Police Scotland's complaints database. Although this list is not exhaustive, these are some of the ways the bill seeks to enhance the efficiency, transparency, independence and public confidence in the police complaints process. Finally, section 17 covers the governance of the PIRC and requires there to be a statutory advisory board to the Commissioner. I believe that this advisory board will strengthen the PIRC's decision-making and will be beneficial to counselling the PIRC on governance and administrative matters. From my time on committee scrutinising this bill, I can confirm that the committee acknowledged that the police complaint system must improve, both for those making a complaint and those who are the subject of a complaint, and we did hear really compelling evidence, as others have outlined, particularly the convener, from those who have experienced the system. The committee does believe that the measures in the bill will improve the robustness, accountability and transparency of the police complaint system, and that the committee welcome greater powers for the PIRC and increased transparency around their investigations. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the policy objectives of this bill, is to ensure that there are robust, clear and transparent mechanisms in place for investigating complaints, allegations of misconduct or other issues of concern in relation to the conduct of police officers in Scotland. I want to put on record again my gratitude to the hard-working, committed individuals who deliver such a high standard of policing in Scotland. This is a mutually beneficial bill to those working in the police service and the general public across Scotland, with still a lot of work to do, as others have highlighted. If it may progress to stage two, I will be supporting the general principles of the bill this evening, and I call on all my colleagues across the chamber to do likewise. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking the Justice Committee for their work on this bill and a thorough report which it has produced. While the committee has backed the bill, it has expressed concerns over whether the reform it seeks will make sufficient improvement to the police complaint system, the culture within policing, or the confidence of the public in dealing effectively with police complaints. There are concerns which need to be addressed as the bill progresses, and this afternoon's debate is an opportunity to focus on where improvements can be made. Other speakers will talk more about the approach of the police or their legal understanding of the bill. I'm going to focus my remarks on what it seeks to do to improve the experience of victims and the public more generally. The bill needs to be looked at in the wider context of work to improve the police complaints and conduct systems. But that also means we need to consider the environment that this legislation will operate in terms of faith in the system as it stands, in terms of public opinion on the police service, and in terms of the known experience of those who have gone through the processes that have been in place up to this point. Before I move on to the committee report and recommendations, I would like to speak briefly about Sheku Bayo, who died in police custody in 2015. More than 9 years on from his death, the public inquiry into the circumstances surrounding it are ongoing, and his family and friends are still seeking answers on what happened as they continue to cope with the impact of their loss. They were not treated well immediately after Sheku's death and experienced a lack of information and engagement at the time of trauma and distress, which unfortunately continued as investigations went on. Through the process, his family lost faith and confidence in the police investigation and in the ability of Park. It is with their experience in mind that I have read the committee's report and its recommendations. As has been recognised across the chamber and endorsed, that the vast majority of police officers and staff are honest and hard-working in what can be very challenging roles. But it's also true that there have been unacceptable conduct and behaviour from minority within the service. When it comes to the oversight role of the SPA, there needs to be confidence that when these behaviours occur, robust measures are in place to deal with them. The committee heard evidence of unacceptable practice within Police Scotland, but it is not clear why such practice was not identified and addressed by the SPA, and what is changing to ensure that others will not have the same experience. The public needs to have confidence that the culture within policing is being addressed. We know that since the Angelini review, there have been steps taken to improve police complaints and conduct, and this bill is one aspect of that. But as the report states, it is hard to have a definitive view on what stage of progress things are at or whether the provisions in the bill will sufficiently improve the experience for police or for the public. In looking at the duty of candour, this needs to be more than a symbolic gesture. There is a perception which is expressed within the report that the police have each other's backs and of a working environment where it is difficult to admit mistakes or call out inappropriate behaviour. We need to think about how this duty will do more than the existing requirements to address that. And this underlines why the legislation has to sit within a broader cultural shift. As without tackling that, it is difficult to see what will change. I welcome that the evidence highlights work such as the Police Scotland's Policing Together programme that recognises the need to enable a more open environment that allows for early intervention. I recognise that the Angelini review called for a duty of cooperation as part of the conduct regulations that would apply if officers were called as witnesses, but the Scottish Government have said that this would not be freestanding. In line with the committee's call, I would like further information on why this won't be introduced, particularly in light of the evidence from Park in support of it. I will touch on some of the other aspects of the bill that could have positive impacts for the public. In allegations of misconduct where a police officer resigns or retires during investigations, there is a case to be made for these processes to be concluded. We need to consider the public expectation that in instances of gross misconduct, a conclusion has to be reached. The committee noted broad agreement in the creation of a Scottish Police Advisory List and the Scottish Police Barred List, which would bring consistency with other forces and improve vetting. and publishing the barred list, but only allowing relevant organisations to have access to the advisory list, as it is in England and Wales, could provide some reassurance in terms of protection and accountability for the public. When looking at gross misconduct hearings, the committee was not able to agree on whether they should be held in public and has called on the Scottish Government to set out the case for this. Lady Angelini was in favour of these being in public, pointing to the importance of transparency around any abuse of power, as well as similarities in other professional proceedings. I accept there have been concerns raised in terms of privacy concerns, but there should be safeguards in place, and we should remember we are talking about cases of gross misconduct, and if we are serious about improving transparency and assuring the public, then this kind of approach could help with that. Finally, regarding complaint handling reviews, the bill would allow PIRC to carry out a review without a request by the complainer, Police Scotland or the SPA, if it were in the public interest, and could make recommendations that the SPA and police would be required to respond to. We know there are victims whose experience of PIRC has not been positive, and the committee heard evidence of a lack of transparency from PIRC when it comes to reporting the outcomes of reviews, including on the time taken and in terms of understanding the decisions that are reached. And taking forward this part of the bill, we need to ensure there is transparency around that process and the publication of information, including making those concerned aware of any relevant review and whether the outcome would be made public, would be welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Baker. I now call on Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Our generous 6 minutes, Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as a substitute member of the Criminal Justice Committee, I'm pleased to take part in today's debate. And as we have a bill in front of us about policing, I reflected back on my time as a councillor in Aberdeen, reflecting not just my time on the Grampian Joint Police Board, which included me being a member of the subcommittee that dealt with police complaints, or the numerous community council meetings or the committees which had police officers in attendance, or the general catch-ups with officers who worked tirelessly across my ward and across Aberdeen, but to my colleagues on the council. When I stood down from Aberdeen City Council, more than a quarter of my colleagues within the SNP group had served in the police in some way or another, Audrey Nicholl, our Criminal Justice Committee convener, being amongst them. The common theme from all of my experience with police officers, serving or retired, has always been their professionalism and the standards they personally upheld. The reputation of the police force meant a lot to them, and that reputation helped them in carrying out their duties. When you consider the situations that police officers often find themselves in, dealing with folk who are angry, upset, grieving, and generally at the extremes of a whole range of emotions, well, actually, there's two things to consider. Firstly, the presence of a police officer can help calm a situation because folk have an expectation of how they will act and behave. That expectation comes from the highest of standards that we demand from and that we receive from thousands of police officers across Scotland. On the other hand, frequently putting our officers in those situations like that increases the chance that they will be in a situation when something goes wrong, or even when everything is done right, that the outcome is distressing or that someone is aggrieved. It is for those situations in particular that I hope this bill can improve the experiences for police officers and complainants alike, and that it can help to protect the reputation of Police Scotland that officers across Scotland will often rely upon. And I want to stress the point of how the reputation of our police force benefits and even helps protect every single officer. That's not unique to the police, and I think the best comparison is to our armed forces, who also work tirelessly to maintain their standards and their reputations, who go to great lengths to protect that reputation, and who have seen that it pays dividends in the operations over the years. From looking at all of the work that the committee did, it is clear that there are a number of folk, both those who raised complaints and those that were subject of complaints, who felt that the current arrangements could and should be improved upon. It is pleasing that there is a committee support for the principles of this bill and that so many proposals are welcomed. Equally, there does need to be a recognition of the hurdles this bill must overcome after today. I also note that there was disagreement within the committee about whether gross misconduct hearings should be held in public and questions about what in public means. And in all honesty, I can understand both sides of the argument. The Scottish Police Federation and Association of Scottish Police Superintendents both raised concerns about allowing former constables to be investigated, although one witness did talk of their preference that the investigation into them had been allowed to conclude after their resignation. And as the Cabinet Secretary said in her opening speech, there was also questions about time limits to investigate complaints against former officers, with 12 months being talked of, but not as a hard and fast statutory requirement, and that it would be for the Commissioner to make a judgment on public interest and fairness. And I'm wondering if we may see situations where officers who leave the force before this bill is passed be investigated under the Act, and what considerations there have been around the retrospective element of that. Maybe the Cabinet Secretary could address this in her summing up. The report also notes the concerns about costs, and in this new era of Labour austerity, every penny is going to be a prisoner. There is a lot for the committee and the government to consider as this bill moves forward, but today is about the general principles of this bill, and I am pleased to support those principles. It is, of course, part of a wider picture that has seen Police Scotland and the Scottish Government implement a number of changes in recent years, prompted by the review led by Dame Eilish Angelini. There is a lot that both Police Scotland and the Scottish Government have already implemented following the work that Dame Eilish undertook, and I look forward to seeing this bill moving forward, becoming legislation, complementing that work, and helping to build the Scotland that we all want to see. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dunbar. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Ben McPherson. Again, a generous 6 minutes. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this Stage 1 debate on Police Ethics Standards and Scrutiny Bill. Scotland's brave police officers play a hugely important role in keeping our communities safe. These individuals work in some of the most challenging circumstances imaginable. They are often forced to put their own safety at risk in order to support others and do their job effectively. No one would question that the police officers deserve our utmost gratitude and respect. At the same time, given the important role that police officers play in keeping our country safe, it is right that they are held to the highest professional standards. Indeed, public trust in our police depends on this becoming the case, Presiding Officer. Public trust also depends on there being a robust, transparent complaint system in order to that they perceive any abuse of authority and that can be challenged and reasonably, and it is fair to see that. I was a member of Tayside Joint Police Board for 15 years, and I had the privilege as a councillor serving on the complaints subcommittee, and I saw firsthand many of the issues that are being raised here today. On this issue, we see that there is currently the system is far from perfect. And Dame Aisling's report, she spoke about the current police complaint system being inaccessible by the public. Now, that is a major issue, if that is to be believed and is the case. It is also important that we understand the range that is often and the complexities that take place when dealing with complaints. And when taking evidence on the bill, the Criminal Justice Committee heard from several witnesses that they felt let down by Police Scotland's Professional Standards Department, including one who said the system needs to be changed completely. It should be scrapped, reset and replaced with something completely new. Now, for that to be the case, that once again raises alarm bells as to what the public think when they're going through that standard. As many MSPs within this chamber will deal with constituents who felt let down by the process, which fails to engage and give them the concerns they want. I have been dealing with and assisting a constituent who has navigated the complete complaints process for over 2 years. And after feeling like police officers had turned a blind eye to his concerns, he then proceeded with a lengthy complaint handling review. At the end of that ordeal, he now feels exhausted and frustrated by the complaint system, which he does believe let him down, and it's not transparent, and it should be fixed. So no doubt there are other members across the chamber today that may have heard similar stories, and we've heard from others this afternoon about that, presiding officer. These benches therefore welcome the new legislation, which seeks to make improvements in the areas and to see that there will be support across the chamber if that is truly going to be achieved. That is why it's vitally important that the bill delivers genuine change instead of just appearing to give change. However, in the current format, it's far obvious that the bill does not deliver some of the bold objectives that we want. We welcome and see the changes that introduce the Scottish Police Barrier List and the closing of loopholes such as the ones that officers to avoid investigation by retiring and resigning. The Criminal Justice Committee report highlights that overall the bill is unlikely to improve the time that it takes to deal with complaints, which is one of the biggest problems with the current system, presiding officer. The Scottish Police Federation have highlighted that the proposed Code of Ethics is likely to see no noticeable effect in the overall policing standards. So no noticeable effect. That is, once again, quite concerning. For those constituents, and many of them who have felt let down by the current system, the reforms of the bill is a missed opportunity. A number of concerns have also been raised around the cost implications when we come to the, and we've already heard some of these expressed in the chamber this afternoon. Since the financial memorandum was published, some aspects of the bill have seen entirely new costs introduced. For example, we know that they're looking at revised costs of £1.5 million when we're dealing with one-off police standards training costs. Given this, it's hardly surprising that our own Finance Committee has accused the Scottish Government of providing figures which already are inaccurate. Now, we shouldn't have inaccurate figures being provided at this stage. It's also, I welcome the fact that the Justice Secretary has confirmed that the updated financial memorandum will be provided in stage two, but that should have been provided as much as possible at stage one. At the same time, it is also disappointing to hear that the bill's costs could still rise even further, and my colleague Russell Finlay spoke about that in his opening remarks. The important work that's carried out by the police across Scotland requires significant authority in the turn and accountability. We recognise that. We all recognise that. It's important that the system in place to hold the police officers to account is transparent, fair and robust, and the public have confidence in that, presiding officer. This bill makes a lot of the right noises about making improvements and trying to tackle some of the areas, and it ticks some of the boxes that individuals and in organisations have talked about when it talks about its general principles. However, it has got a long way to go in delivering the reforms that many people want to see. So I hope as it does progress, that opportunities are given for that. This bill is an opportunity to genuinely reform and we can see real change. So in conclusion, presiding officer, we on this side welcome the fact and we want to see this bill progress, but it also has to progress with having real opportunities, not missed opportunities by the Scottish Government. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Martin Whitfield, again a generous 6 minutes. Mr. McPherson.
Thank you, presiding officer. And as a new member of the Criminal Justice Committee, I'm very pleased to speak in today's important debate on the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill at Stage 1, and also as a constituency MSP. As others have remarked across the chamber, we are served very well across Scotland by the exceptional dedication and commitment of Scotland's police officers and all the work, the diverse work that they do to keep communities safe. In Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, I'm grateful for the weekly collaboration that I engage in with Police Scotland to serve constituents on a range of matters, and their professionalism is exceptional. However, no organisation is perfect, we all know that, and if things go wrong, the police must be held to account and improvements made. lessons must be learned and complaints and justice internally must be thorough and robust, and sanction must be used where it is appropriate and right. And some of the hardest cases that I've dealt with as a constituency MSP in terms of their complexity and sensitivity are those with regard to complaints against the criminal justice system, and I'm sure colleagues have experienced that as well. And so, as a country that polices by consent, as others have said, and this being so central to our justice system, we must have appropriate accountability, strong accountability, and new laws like the one we are considering today must be brought through in due course through modernisation and to future-proof public confidence in standards of police conduct. The vital safeguards set out in this legislation will enhance the professional service already delivered by officers as they perform their privileged duties to keep us all safe, and I'll say more about that in a minute. But that essential service and privileged duty is just something I want to touch on a bit more before getting into the key proposals in the bill. Without meaning to discuss the jurisprudence of this legislation before us today too much, of course, key to the rule of law is enforcement and fair and accountable enforcement. And if the state is to have a monopoly of violence, and for that monopoly of violence to be for just and benevolent ends, and not something that was necessarily the case historically, as Maggie Chapman highlighted in her remarks, but certainly in the modern period, the upholding of democracy is absolutely reliant on a strong police service to enforce the rule of law and for that to be fair and accountable. And this bill, of course, will enhance that. The bill puts the already pre-existing code of ethics, which is currently embedded throughout policing, on a statutory footing in a way which will ensure a thorough review process and accountability for its widespread publication. And the bill will make the code of ethics legally binding, and that is something I welcome. In terms of complaints against the police, the bill, as others have touched on, aims to simplify the process. That's something that I welcome, and I know constituents will too. It aims to simplify the process to ensure that there are robust mechanisms in place for investigating complaints in a timeous way and allegations of misconduct and other issues of concern in relation to the conduct of police officers in Scotland. The bill also provides to give greater powers for the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, otherwise known as PIRC, and requirements on Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority to respond to PIRC's recommendations and provide the Commissioner with direct access to relevant information, as well as the commencement or conclusion of gross misconduct proceedings, regardless of whether the person leaves the police or continues in the service. And I think this will be warmly welcomed. And actually, one question I wonder if the government may be able to comment on in conclusion, although this might be something for later stages at 2 and 3, what greater public awareness will be undertaken in terms of initiatives by the government to continue to raise awareness amongst the public on how to lodge a complaint in a appropriate manner if they have concerns about the service they've received. Other measures in the bill that are to be welcomed are the introduction of Scottish advisory and barred lists, and the setting out of a duty of candour to ensure the police cooperate fully during investigations of allegations against constables. There's more in the bill, and I look forward to the debate at stage two, but I would just want to conclude by quoting an important statement that was made by Lady Angelini with regard to formalising the delivery of the majority of the recommendations made by her review in 2018. She had said this in evidence to the committee that, in her words, I do not think that having a voluntary version is good enough for an organisation that has so much power. It is really important that there is a structure to that in terms of the making sure that we undertake a formalisation of her review. So for those who maybe question the necessity of this legislation, I think Lady Angelini's statement there is worth remembering. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Christine Graham. Again, a generous 6 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is a pleasure to follow Ben McPherson and actually to echo his very last comments about the motion, the movement of a voluntary code into a statutory code, because I would like to take the relatively short time that I have to discuss three aspects of this bill. But before doing so, again, like others, can I thank the committee for their phenomenal work and very full report that's been published, and indeed the Scottish Government's response to this. I wanted to start with a discussion about ethics, because the bill rightly talks about ethics, as does so much of the evidence that the committee heard, and the importance of what that is and what we mean by it, and the fact that ethics underpins those normalities of conduct that distinguish simply what is between acceptable and unacceptable behaviour. And much of the debate this afternoon has revolved around the effect of these ethics sinking into the police force and those that work for the police force. But the reason for those ethics is to underpin the public belief, confidence, security, and indeed to complete the foundation that we do police by consent in this country. So even though the discussions within the bill talk very much about ethics and indeed some other matters, I think it's right to remember the public in respect of this, because it's only through showing a high, indeed higher ethical standard than others, that a continuation of the confidence in the police, indeed a rebuilding of the confidence in the police by some of the elements of our communities, will occur. And so the purposes that sit behind the intentions of this bill are truly welcome. And it is right that we have both a robust, transparent statutory process with places to investigate misconduct and complaints and uphold the very high standards expected of the Scotland's police officer and Scottish police staff, but also one that a significant majority of the existing police officers and those that serve in the Scottish police already adhere to. And it is to celebrate that good practice that I think no one should fear in respect of an ethics-based police force. We have here the existing code, again, that Ben McPherson made mention of, that will become the first statutory ethical code by the process of this bill. And one of the questions that I would like to ask the government is in relation to the bill envisages a review at 5 years. Is that five-year review considered for this very first code, which actually is based on a code that goes back many, many decades in some cases and elements of it? Or are the Scottish Government envisaging a review of that code at a much shorter period to show that it actually represents the sort of policing by consent that our communities want? So if the Scottish Government are able to, if the Cabinet Secretary, my apologies, is able to comment on that, I would find that very useful. The second area that I want to turn to is with regard to candour, which is contained in Section 3. Again, we don't have a definition of candour within the bill, but I think most people would say it's just to be open and honest, tell the truth. But tell the truth even when it's quite difficult sometimes to do that because of events that have happened to the individual or indeed to their colleagues. And one of the challenges that I'm glad that this bill tries to deal with is to open up the relationship within police officers, within different levels of police officer, within the various roles within the police service, to allow that duty of candour to come through, to be able to tell the truth in difficult circumstances. And I note, as the Cabinet Secretary confirmed, the individual duty on the office of constable, but also the organisational duty that applies to the Chief Constable. And the reason for my intervention earlier was in respect of the fact that we already have a duty of candour defined in Scotland here under the NHS duty of candour that applies specifically to the system that is the NHS, and whether or not the Scottish Government have considered a similar statutory definition would assist, in particular, the Chief Constable. And I would draw attention to the statutory instrument of 2018, number 57, which sets that out, and whether or not that is, in fact, an appropriate vehicle that perhaps should be considered in this point. The final area that I would like to deal with is one that a number of members across the board and indeed the committee have referred to, which is with regard to the financial memorandum and the role of financial memorandums. And there seems to have been not a misunderstanding but a disagreement perhaps as to when and how and the role that they play. And the standing orders clearly set out that the financial memorandum that should accompany the bill must give the best estimate of the timescales over which costs, savings and changes to revenue would be expected to arise. And that subsequent to that, unless there are substantial changes in the bill, a further financial memorandum wouldn't be needed. However, I think this case, as a number have done with recent legislation, has shown that there is substantial difference between the bill that was envisaged that comes forward at stage one and where it gets to even before this stage one debate. And I think there is a heavy onus on the Scottish Government to ensure a better, more accurate calculation of the financial consequences of the legislation that's been considered. And I have to say, I welcome the contribution of the Cabinet Secretary to the committee on Tuesday, the 7th of May, where she recognised that there was perhaps a shortfalling in this case, but also recognised that the bill that was presented to the committee was substantially different to the one that was originally envisaged when that first financial memorandum was forthcoming. But I do think it's something that as a Parliament we should look at. But as with others across the board, with reservations, very much welcome this bill, and we see how that develops in the discussions and arguments as we have going forward. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Before calling the final speaker in the opening debate, just a reminder that all members who have participated in the debate should be in the chamber for closing speeches. And with that, I call Christine Graham again, a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I too congratulate the committee on this report? And of course, at this stage of the debate, much has been said, so I apologise in advance for revisiting points that have already been made. Let me preface my contribution by stating clearly, as others have done, and I think which we all endorse, namely, that the overwhelming majority of police officers carry out the vast range of their duties professionally and ethically. Duties ranging from theft, road traffic accidents, drug investigations, helping folk with mental health issues, neighbour disputes, domestic abuse, social disorder, to murder itself. The circumstances of these can vary as much as the incidents. Those I've identified from simply being gently helpful to someone who is confused to threats to their own life by a mob or individual. You've got to be ready for practically anything. This is in a society where regard for police is not as it was in the days, and here I show my age, every over 70 will understand this, of the fictional Dixon of Doc Green, or even the more recent but still distant Zed cars. Respect these days for those in any position of authority has to be earned. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Police also, thankfully, in this democracy, police by consent. Therefore, trust in the police must prevail, and this is most tested when policing goes wrong. Now, in every organisation, there will be bad eggs. The police force is no exception. Who suffers from bad policing? The public. The individual, of course, but also every other police officer. Currently on the Police Scotland website, there are directions on how to complain. For example, simply what is a complaint? Investigating your claim. It explains about PIRC, the Police Investigations Review Commissioner, and criminal allegations against the Police Force Division, which is part of the Crown Office. What if you're unhappy about your complaint? What happens to it? I quote again from the Police Scotland site. Quote, if the reasons for your complaint are clear and we see it as a minor non-criminal complaint, we will record it. An officer from our professional standards department will contact you to discuss the details of your complaint. It may be that we can resolve your complaint quickly by providing information or explanation. If we need to look at your complaint in more detail, our professional standards team will record it and contact you to explain the next steps. Your complaint may be allocated to an investigator to carry out further inquiry. If you make a complaint direct to PIRC, they will direct you back to Police Scotland. We will then follow the same process as if you had contacted us directly. Close quote. So as Dame Eilish Angelini has conceded, it was a reasonably good system already, but there was room for improvement. One of the major strengthening parts of the bill is that an offending officer cannot escape discipline, punitive measures, simply by retiring and avoiding any outcome of a finding of gross misconduct, a practice too often used an escape route and totally indefensible. Another is that it also creates a barred and advisory list to stop those who do not meet the high standards expected of police officers from gaining employment in policing, indeed anywhere in the UK. I'm going to conclude this a brief contribution by referring to my experience as an MSP in my dealings with the police. And again, the vast majority of cases, we've worked as a team, often in the interest of a vulnerable constituent. I have had, and this has been referenced by previous speakers, however rarely, I have experienced slipshod policing and only using what pressure I could bring to bear ensure my constituents' concerns were appropriately addressed. That should not have been necessary. But I repeat, my contact over 25 years has been overwhelmingly positive. So I welcome the bill weeding out those who fail the high standards required rightly of our police service, making those found guilty of gross misconduct pay the price for that, strengthening PIRC to ensure public confidence in the whole complaints procedure, either complaints by public against police or indeed police against fellow officers. But one important issue, this must ensure the balance is struck in fairness to the complainer and those subject to the complaint. That is crucial. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. We now move to closing speeches, and I call firstly Maggie Chapman again. A generous 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank colleagues for their contributions to this afternoon's debate. As someone who does not sit on the Criminal Justice Committee but follows its work from the outside, it's always interesting to see how different committee members and also others from outside, like myself, understand and interpret committee proceedings. If we were starting from scratch to empower our communities to deal with the problems in their midst, problems of violence, of theft and damage, problems of how to keep people safe at large gatherings, on streets and highways, problems of contested uses of public space, problems of acting, as the police so very often do, as the agency of last resort for people with histories of pain and trauma. If we were beginning that work now, I don't think the creation of the institution of a police force would be our chosen answer, or at least not the only one. We need to think about how to reform the way that police do their work and how they are accountable, how to enact those reforms, how to ensure that they are properly implemented, how to scrutinise and exercise that power that they have. Because it is right that we as citizens expect the highest of standards in all aspects of the work that the police do. As Jamie Green, Russell Findlay and others have said, that process of reform is not a one-off. It must be ongoing. Policing by consent relies on trust, and it only takes one bad experience, one negative headline, to destroy that trust. Unfortunately, we've had more than one bad experience, one negative headline, as far as institutionalised discrimination in the police is concerned. And the committee heard too many examples of breaches of that trust by individuals too. And once that trust is broken, it takes concerted effort and no small amount of time to rebuild that trust. This bill is a part of that process of reform and of rebuilding and rebuilding that trust as process. I do share the concerns raised by some this afternoon that many of the Angelini review recommendations are not in this bill. I would welcome the Cabinet Secretary providing some further information as to how her government will approach these, if not today, then in the future. I'm not going to rehearse what we've already heard so much about this afternoon, the different elements of the bill before us today: the ethics code, the duty of candour, the changes to PERC and its governance, and so on. But I am interested in the details of the amendments that have been suggested this afternoon, and I will listen with interest to the Cabinet Secretary's closing remarks in this regard. And I hope that ongoing discussions during stage two will address some of the questions that Pauline McNeill and others have raised. Presiding Officer, as I indicated earlier, I do believe that as part of the ongoing reform of our police service and the way they do their work, we also need to think about how we might divest the police of functions better carried out by other agencies, by other workers, without the punitive load that the police inevitably, whether they want to or intend to or not, bring to every encounter. Ultimately, we need to ask ourselves whether what we say is the central function of the police to keep people safe is ever going to be compatible with what historically it has been its actual raison d'etre, to preserve the establishment, the status quo, to protect elites by suppressing some marginalised groups, to resist that transformation of society that we now, in our overlapping crises, need more than ever to survive. There are, I know, many police officers who recognise these contradictions and who want to be part of that positive transformation. So while we make the incremental changes that we can, such as with this bill, let us keep faith with those within and outside the police who look to us ultimately for a vision of something more, of a police system that serves all members of our community and a society where we can all trust them to do what they are there to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call on Katie Clark, around 7 minutes or so.
Thank you. And as has been said, this bill comes before us as a result of the Angelini review. The Criminal Justice Committee heard evidence from a number of witnesses who had had complaints put about their treatment by the police. And as the convener said, we also heard evidence from a former police officer who'd had a complaint made against him. I think that all members of the committee would agree that some of the evidence we heard was harrowing, shocking, and raised very serious issues about policing in Scotland. As Maggie Chapman said in her opening contribution, power has sometimes been abused. It is far from clear to me that the contents of the bill we are discussing today, if enacted, would have made any difference to those witnesses' experiences. Police Scotland itself has accepted that it has been institutionally racist and discriminatory. Indeed, the testimony of many women police officers of sexist and misogynistic treatment that they've experienced in the police force is unacceptable. As Rona Mackay said, cultural change is essential. The appointment of the first woman police chief constable is very welcome, and we hope this is part of the acceleration of this cultural change. Ben McPherson and Martin Whitfield spoke about the code of ethics, which my colleague Martin Whitfield asked should be reviewed. I believe that when looking at this bill before us today, we need to consider whether the changes in this bill will make a real difference. The bar list included in this bill is very welcome. It is unclear whether this legislation is needed to enable that to happen, but the Sarah Everard case, of course, is probably the most high-profile recent UK case, which demonstrates why a bar list, but also the continuous and robust scrutiny of the suitability of police officers for their role is required. And I welcome that additional resources have already been put into this work. Claire Baker spoke about the Shaco Bio inquiry and Jackie Dunbar about her experiences of the policing committee. We also need to look carefully at the wider structures for police accountability. Because the Cabinet Secretary is, of course, correct to state very clearly that trust in the police force is of paramount importance. The ethics, conduct and governance of the police require an appropriate framework, and any legislation we pass must drive greater public confidence. The duty of candour, of course, already exists. It is unclear whether a higher standard of behaviour is required should this legislation be enacted. The duty of candour, which exists, for example, in the health service, is wide-ranging. As Pauline McNeill said, we need to clarify and be clear as to what the duty of candour will mean in a police setting. On this and on many other technical aspects of this legislation, Scottish Labour's view is that the detail should be on the face of the bill. We look forward to seeing the Cabinet Secretary's amendments regarding the duty of candour for operational staff, and hope that there will be clarity as to the implications this will have for individuals. And also, if she would address the concerns which are being raised by the police civilian trade union Unison in this regard. Many of the issues raised in the committee, of course, relate to the individual employment rights of police officers. And of course, their rights must be respected. But the overriding concern with this bill must be to ensure greater transparency and a more speedy and just resolution of complaints made by the public and indeed by other police officers. Alexander Stewart said that improved standards were essential. The park itself has indicated that it does not wish some of the powers which it is being suggested should be transferred to it under this Act. And I agree with Jamie Green that this is very concerning, and I hope that that also is something that the Cabinet Secretary will specifically address and give an explanation for. Scottish Labour has made our concerns about the financial memorandum clear. We will support the bill today, as Pauline McNeill said, in good faith, on the basis that they will be addressed at a later stage of this bill. So to conclude, we will support this legislation today, even though we are not convinced that it will make the significant cultural shift that would be essential if we were actually to address some of the very significant concerns that were raised by witnesses who gave evidence to the Criminal Justice Committee. I therefore believe that much more needs to be done, some of which may not require legislation, to actually ensure that we deal with complaints adequately that are raised about the police, that we drive the cultural change that is clearly essential, and that we ensure that the people of Scotland have the highest trust and public confidence in their police force. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Clark. And I now call Sharon Dowie, again, around 8 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As part of the Criminal Justice Committee considering this bill, I've been involved in scrutinising it for some time, and can I take this opportunity to thank all the clerks and the staff in Spice for their help in the process, and also a special mention to Sean, who I'm sure is at home watching us live on screen as we're speaking just now. Let me also declare at the outset that my husband is a former police officer. This bill aims to improve the police complaint system, which is currently failing not only victims, but also ordinary officers who just want to go on with their job and serve the public. We all agree on the need for reform, but it must be the right kind of reform, as many MSPs today have said eloquently. Today's debate has been productive and useful. MSPs across the Chamber have made many strong points worthy of consideration. This debate has highlighted some areas of the bill that must be improved, and it's also thrown up particular problems that the Government must address. Whilst we all agree on the need for reform, we need to ensure that the bill is accurately costed and that it achieves the aims it intends to. PIRC have produced a substantial response to the committee's Stage 1 report. The bill seeks to enhance the powers of PIRC, but PIRC themselves have raised significant concerns about their ability to take on some of these functions and the appropriateness of these. It may be prudent of the Scottish Government to consider these concerns in greater detail going forward. Before I come to the specific points raised by various MSPs today, I want to first outline the main issue that must be looked at in the aftermath of today's debate. The cost of the bill appears to be the most significant issue. Taxpayers must get good value for money, and they must be made fully aware of the cost of this legislation before it is passed, as must MSPs across this chamber. As many noted, the cost of the bill appears to have been significantly underestimated by the SNP government. The initial financial prediction was £1.4 million. It is now £5.8 million. This is an increase of £4.4 million, and we still may not have the final figure. A significant portion of the increased costs is to ensure that all constables and police staff have read and understood the Statutory Code of Ethics. As stated by Dr. Lennon during the committee's evidence session, and I quote, putting the Code of Ethics on a statutory footing is symbolically important. Without making it a disciplinary code, I am not sure how much a difference it will make day to day, and we need to make sure that the legislation that we are passing is going to make a difference. And I'm going to jump on at the moment to a comment that Russell Finlay made in his opening remarks, which were in body-worn cameras. So one thing that I also want to raise, talking about value for money, is the use of body-worn cameras, which offer significant advantages to both police officers and victims. These cameras would reduce the need for extensive follow-up with individuals, alleviating the burden not only in victims but also in officers. The cost effectiveness of implementing body-worn cameras is substantial, as it would solve many current issues in the criminal justice process. Unfortunately and disappointingly, the rollout looks like it could be delayed until 2025, despite clear benefits. But this technology needs to be prioritised and rolled out swiftly. As noted by Michelle McLeod, PIRC, during the committee's evidence session, and I quote, I add that the rollout of body-worn cameras will be a game-changer for us and for police officers against whom allegations are made. In many cases, we will be able to look at the body-worn camera footage and make a much more rapid decision than we can currently if no such footage exists. Body-worn cameras have the potential to significantly change behaviours and improve outcomes across various areas, including mental health and victim protection. So if we're looking for value for money, I really urge that we get these rolled out much quicker. The Finance Committee accused the Scottish Government of providing figures that it knew were completely inaccurate. It is possible that the financial provisions could be revised upwards further. I would have liked to have received a guarantee from the Cabinet Secretary today that this will not happen, but I don't believe that such a guarantee would be possible. I await the revised financial memorandum, which has been promised, with great interest, because it seems entirely likely that the costs are still not close to the reality. Since the Government's initial financial predictions, total one-off costs have nearly tripled, total recurring costs have nearly quintupled. And if this isn't enough to set alarm bells ringing, then I don't know what will. Given the SNP's record in financial mismanagement and the current situation they find themselves in after 17 years of being in charge of the country's finances, it is vital that the true costs of this bill are established quickly. The Government cannot wait until the last minute to produce full and detailed costings that accurately reflect how much this bill will cost taxpayers. The fiscally responsible and accountable thing to do would be to provide all available information as soon as possible. I hope this happens, but we need to make sure that we have transparency. Turning to the excellent contributions from the MSPs across the chamber today, Jamie Green, MSP, spoke about the scale of complaints against the police that go unsolved. While I believe the overwhelming majority of police officers do their jobs with the utmost professionalism and dedication, A very small minority do not, yet they do not appear to be facing the consequences. Russell Finlay, MSP, who spoke about specific examples of misconduct and the struggle for the victims to have those incidents investigated, disturbing examples that he raised are exactly why reform of the system is so essential. Fulton MacGregor, MSP, rightly outlined that the complaints process is not only broken for the public, it's also failing officers themselves. The bill is not about criticising good police officers, it's about helping them, supporting them and freeing them to go about their work without suffering misconduct, abuse or harassment. And it was mentioned by the Police Federation about error terror, so we need to make sure that the police feel confident that they can come and admit if something has happened and it's been a mistake, they need to be able to come and see that or say that to their superiors without fear. Rona Mackay and also Martin Whitfield made very well-considered points on information around the Code of Ethics. Given the importance of getting this right, it is vital the Code is of the highest standard. I don't believe the Government has yet set out clearly enough the detail around the development of this Code. The statutory obligation would be in Police Scotland to prepare this Code, but there are still many questions the Government needs to answer about its scope. Pauline McNeill also raised the proposed duty of candour and the lack of clarity around this. Claire Baker raised the issue of misconduct proceedings and them reaching a conclusion. Part 6 of the bill allows for gross misconduct proceedings to continue or commence in respect of persons who have ceased to be constables. The committee asked the Scottish Government to clarify the timeframe for the continuation of misconduct proceedings and raised concerns about the proceedings taking longer than necessary. Alexander Stewart, MSP, was right to also raise these issues and highlight the need for more work in this element of the bill. Timescales was a major concern that we heard quite a few occasions when we heard the evidence. Another point raised by the committee, which has been discussed at length today, is the need for the Scottish Government to give consideration to the strong objections by the Police Investigation and Review Commissioner and how the bill would enhance her role. There does appear to be a need to give further consideration to objections that PIRC could assume the role of the presentation of cases at senior officer misconduct hearings, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary will provide further clarification on this in due course. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, while we agree on the need for a bill like this, we are concerned by some aspects of the legislation before us. The need for reform is clear, we can all fully get behind that, but it shouldn't mean writing a blank cheque from taxpayers to the SNP Government. The costs of the bill must be properly established to allow us to scrutinise it properly, and transparency should not be treated as an inconvenience by the Government. The Scottish Conservatives want to see reform that improves the police complaint system and ensures it is fair, effective and delivered in a cost-efficient manner. While we welcome the intent of this bill, we need to see further clarity and confirmation of its true cost to ensure we create a fair, efficient and transparent complaint system. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. And I now call on Angela Constance to wind up, Cabinet Secretary, a very generous 10 minutes.
Well, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's very unusual for you to say that to me, and I suppose all I can say in return is be careful what you wish for. Can I start by thanking all members for their contribution today? I will do my best to answer the questions that have been raised in chamber, but if indeed I run out of time or can't read my own handwriting, I will endeavour to write to members with the further detail that they all seek. I will principally make sure my remarks stick to the bill, with one exception, and I want to agree with members who have stressed the central importance of body-worn cameras, because I agree 100% that body-worn cameras or videos protects officers from malicious allegations, but they also allows for quicker and more efficient resolution of complaints, and that can only be in interest of victims as well. And I also want to highlight to Chamber that I provided, the Scottish Government provided, both the SPA and Police Scotland with funding for 2024-2025 at record levels to provide them with the resource that they need to roll out cameras to police officers. And notwithstanding that there are operational aspects of this that are absolutely for Police Scotland, I am assured that they are being held to account by the SPA and that progress has been made, particularly with the progression of the contract for body-worn videos. Can I just start by talking about the money? And I want to principally spend a little bit of time addressing issues and concerns around the financial memorandum, because I want to say to everybody in this chamber there is indeed no blank cheque. I, of course, heard the frustrations from both the Criminal Justice Committee and the Finance and Public Audit Committee, and indeed shared some of my own frustrations in that process as well. And of course, this bill was introduced as far back as June 23. The best information that was available at that time was included in the original financial memorandum. The information and the financial assessment changed. Police Scotland, actually for good reasons, changed their assessment of costs on their organisation. But I did, I can assure Chamber, want to robustly test that, because every pound, every public pound, is precious. And I do want to reassure all members that the most up-to-date information is currently available to all members. And for the record, there will be a revised financial memorandum at stage two as per standing orders. And I've also acknowledged that there should have been prompter information available to both committees. And I want to highlight that both the Permanent Secretary and the Minister for Parliamentary Business are indeed engaged on this. Now, in terms of whether costs increase any further, this will be where I will be looking to all members for financially modest stage two and stage three amendments, because I do not want costs to increase any further. Presiding Officer, in terms of the progress that has been made, most members spoke of the importance of that culture of change. And of course, that progress didn't start with this bill. It started with a very honest acknowledgement that change and significant change was needed. And that started when the Dame Elise Angelini review was commissioned. It then progressed when both the Scottish Government and the Crown Office responded to the recommendations in that review in February 2021, and there were 111 recommendations. And prior to these stage one proceedings on the bill, I can confirm, as Parliament is already aware of through earlier information, that 59 out of the 72 non-legislative recommendations are completed. Nine are still progressing, two are nearly completed, and there are two recommendations that are currently being reviewed. And what the purpose of this bill is to take forward the remaining recommendations made by Lady Elise that required to be put in statute, that required legislation. And it was Lady Elise who said, I believe, to the Criminal Justice Committee that instant results are seldom possible and they are seldom sustained. But changing culture is a long game, but it's worth investing time, it is worth investing energy, and it's worth investing in resource to build the solid and enduring foundations. And that's what we as a government, and I believe this chamber, is invested in. In terms of Pauline McNeill's question regarding my contribution around His Majesty Inspectorate of Constabulary for Scotland. What I was referring to, Ms McNeill, was the HMICS recommendations in their vetting report. There was one recommendation in that report for the Scottish Government on vetting. In essence, that was the Scottish Government should place into legislation the requirements that all Police Scotland officers and staff to obtain and maintain a minimum standard of vetting clearance and the provision for the Chief Constable to dispense with the service of an officer or staff who cannot maintain suitable vetting. And so I can confirm that just today the Cabinet Subcommittee on Legislation have agreed to the vetting amendment at stage two, and I will indeed bring that forward, yes.
Pauline McNeill.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for clarifying that point. As we will head to stage two shortly after the stage one report, I just wonder, I have one specific question, but I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could take cognizance of what I said in my opening speech, which is there's a lot of detail which is still quite hard to get your head round on something which is full of detail. One question I wanted to ask was that the Police Scotland has said that they wanted accelerated hearings, and you've said that that already exists under the regulation. I just wondered what your understanding of this request is in relation to accelerated hearings. So, if I read it correctly, you could understand if there was someone failed a drugs test, why would you have to wait? To a long process, but there might be other circumstances where accelerated hearings wouldn't be appropriate. So I just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary agreed that on that detail we need some real clarity around what's being asked for here.
Cabinet Secretary.
In short, Ms McNeill, I can indeed take cognizance of that, and we will endeavour to give as much clarity as possible. Obviously, with many of these recommendations in terms of the detail, in terms of how amendments are narrated and how they are drafted, we have to be cognizant of unintended consequences. So we, just to reassure you, we are delving into the detail as always, and will endeavour to provide as much clarity as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, members also raised the issue of time limits. If I could remind members that statutory time limits were considered by the Dame Elise Angelini review, but she had concluded that they were not appropriate for legislation. But nonetheless, she did say that timescales should be reviewed and published in guidance. Other members spoke of the Professional Standards Department. It is important to remember that PERC conducts annual and audit triages within PSD complaints. The PERC audit reports, including learning points, are now published, and the Scottish Police Authority regularly do some dip sampling into complaints as well. And of course, this is all scrutinised by the Scottish Police Authority via their Complaints and Conduct Committee, and where appropriate, they get input from Audit Scotland. In terms of a question was raised, I think, by Mr Finlay about who holds PERC to account, can I just make one thing absolutely crystal clear? There will be no legislative change to PERC's accountability to this Parliament. There are various bodies who PERC is accountable to. In some instances, that may be the Lord Advocate, and other instances, it will be the Scottish Parliament or the Scottish Government, the Auditor General, but also the SPSO as well. And I also note the discussion and debate this afternoon with respect to the different views. On the one hand, I have heard it narrated that PARC doesn't have enough powers, that it is allegedly toothless. And then on the other hand, I've heard people raise the legitimate concerns, as narrated by the PARC, that they are not convinced by all the additional powers in the bill. But of course, Presiding Officer, it is for all of us as policymakers and lawmakers to resolve differences of opinion. But maybe we should be less worried about organisations that are not at the forefront of grabbing powers but have a natural reticence to that. And I'll take Mr McPherson's intervention.
I believe that was an error.
Presiding Officer, if I could continue and respond to Mr Whitfield's points. Can I just make clear in terms of my first response to him in my opening statement that I was referring to the 2012 Act. I was convinced I said the 2012 Act, but somebody has whispered in my ear I may have said 2020 instead of 2012. Again, Presiding Officer, can I highlight that the initial code of ethics to be introduced will be subject to consultation before being put in place. Then the code of ethics will be updated every 5 years. In terms of the duties that the Chief Constable has, the Chief Constable must seek to ensure that the policing of Scotland is done with due regard to the code of ethics. And in terms of the, I think, perhaps more complex point raised by Mr Whitfield in terms of should there be a definition of candour, and he says specifically with regards to the Chief Constable and that organisational responsibility. While we don't specifically have any plans in that, on the basis that the commentary and evidence given by Lady Elish aligned with the government view that the bill as drafted achieves the outcomes that is sought. However, it would be very remiss of me not to pay some cognizance to the wider debate actually across the UK on issues of duty of candour amongst public servants. So I am alive to that debate, if I can say that to Mr Whitfield. In terms of Ben McPherson, regarding awareness raising amongst the public. It is crucial that there's very clear signposting on all policing partners' websites, but we'll certainly continue to discuss that with members. Presiding Officer, the convener, Audrey Nicholl, when she was speaking with regards to Section 13, where she said the committee is of the view that both PARC and the SBA should be added as prescribed persons in UK legislation. This will provide a relevant independent third party for employees of Police Scotland and the SBA to report whistleblowing concerns to. I suppose, in short, the position of the government is that we are happy to consider this. It is a matter, as I stated in my response to committee, that is out with the bill. We do, however, remain open-minded. It is, of course, a reserved matter, but we'd want to be clear from the committee as to what the benefits that this action would provide, and, you know, if there was a very clear case to be made, we would, of course, you know, enter into discussions with the UK government with regards to that. Presiding Officer, I hope in the time that's been made available to me that I have been able to demonstrate that since the publication of the Dame Elish Angelini's review, that policing in Scotland has been on an improvement trajectory. That doesn't for a minute mean that our journey is over. And I do pay tribute to the collective commitment and actions of our policing partners who have delivered 59 of Dame Elish's recommendations to date and continue to progress those few remaining recommendations recommendations that do not require legislation. In her evidence to the Criminal Justice Committee earlier this year, Lady Elish said, and I quote, "The system in Scotland is possibly nearly as good as you can get. It is always possible to improve the system and to incorporate good ideas that could enhance it, but generally it is significantly better than it was when I started as a young fiscal deputy." And of course, Presiding Officer, that is to be welcomed. However, as many members have warned, there is never any room for complacency. And as we move from stage one to stage two to stage three, we do, of course, have to immerse ourselves in the detail. But the changes since the Dame Elish review have provided much more transparency and accountability. They have improved the accessibility and outcomes for complainants already, and these are sustainable improvements which will set the course for the future. But Lady Elish also told the committee, and again I wish to quote, "You won't be looking at this again for a while, and you want to get it right." And I couldn't agree more with that, and therefore it is the responsibility of all of us in this chamber to ensure that the systems in place serve the best interests of the public and respect the rights of all involved. And that's why Parliament, I hope, will agree the general principles of this very important bill that will improve policing for everyone in Scotland. And if once again, Presiding Officer, if I can thank all members for their contribution, if there are points in relation to the bill that I have not addressed specifically, I'd be more than happy to do so and follow up in writing. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Police, Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and that is consideration of motion 13797 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Police, Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. And I call on Angela Constance to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is an announcement by the Finance and Public Administration Committee on quality and consistency of financial memorandums. And I call on Kenneth Gibson, convener of the committee, to make the announcement. Up to 3 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to make this announcement on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee on a matter which is relevant to us all in this chamber regarding scrutiny of legislation. As members are aware, the committee is responsible for scrutinising the financial memorandum of each bill. We have repeatedly identified issues with the quality of information presented in FMs, as well as a general lack of consistency in how that information is presented, and highlighted our concerns in successive reports and letters to lead committees and to the Scottish Government. In response, the Scottish Government sought a consolidated list of committee expectations around FMs. We subsequently reviewed our scrutiny of recent FMs and the recommendations we made against the guidance available to Scottish Government bill teams, and found that most of our concerns would not have arisen if this guidance had been consistently applied by the relevant bill teams. Many of the recommendations made in our letters and reports are already covered by the Scottish Public Finance Manual. We therefore wrote to the Minister for Parliamentary Business in June, asking the Scottish Government to put in place enhanced training and development for bill teams to improve the quality and consistency of presentation of future FMs. We reiterated a number of specific recommendations in relation to margins of uncertainty, the standard usage of the GDP deflator measure of inflation, a preference for financial information to be set out by reference to specific provisions in a bill, the use of summary tables, and our expectation that unnecessary replication of text from other bill documents should be avoided. We welcome the ensuing commitment from the Minister for Parliamentary Business that the Bill Handbook and other guidance will be updated to reflect our recommendations, and that the Scottish Government will seek to ensure there is consistent application of that guidance in the development of future FMs. The committee suggested that where requested updates on bill costings, for example, on the National Care Service FM, are presented in a coordinated way annually, alongside the Scottish Government's medium-term financial strategy, a matter we will continue to pursue with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government. We also urge the Scottish Government to proactively write to the committee as soon as it becomes aware of any significantly revised figures, including margins of uncertainty, for FMs during stage one of a bill's passage. Again, the committee welcomes the Minister's commitment to revise the Scottish Public Finance Manual to emphasise this requirement. The Finance and Public Administration Committee will continue to monitor the quality and detail provided in FMs, including in relation to framework bills, which can be more challenging to scrutinise and establish overall costs. It's hoped that this updated guidance and renewed focus on training will lead to an improvement in the information presented to Parliament and consequently in the scrutiny of these documents in future. I invite members to draw upon the committee's work in your scrutiny of legislation. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 14398 in the name of Angela Constance on the Police, Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 13797 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Police, Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And that concludes decision time, and we'll now move on to members' business in the name of Kenneth Gibson, and I ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so quietly. Thank you.